This is All India Radio, Power of Listening. Under this series, tonight we take you on a journey to the world of yet another magnificent facet of traditional Indian knowledge systems. I'm Manoj Mayankar. In our previous episode, we talked about the genesis of Zero and also about the Zero Gallery, a unique gallery based on the importance, evolution and history of Zero. In the second part of the episode, on the same theme, we shall be focusing on some more aspects of Zero as mentioned in our traditional Indian knowledge systems and more about the gallery. The expert on the show is Dr. Parthasarathi Mukhopadhyay, Associate Professor, Department of Mathematics, Ramakrishna Mission Residential College, Narendrapur, Kolkata. Talking to him is Dr. Manas Pratim Das. Stay tuned.
Welcome listeners once again to another episode of Power of Listening. Today, we are again at the Narendrapur Ramakrishna Mission Residential College, and we are here to ask a few questions about the Zero Gallery, which has become the talk of the town, probably the talk of the country, and a gallery which tells you about the evolution of Zero, how Zero was invented in Vedic times in India, and how the idea traveled to far-off countries, influenced civilizations in different time periods, and how those civilizations coped with it. Some of those actually rejected the idea of Zero, and some of them actually embraced it so that they could make their arithmetic better. Now, to start with, we would like to ask Professor Parthasarathi Mukhopadhyay, Associate Professor in the Department of Mathematics at the RKM Residential College, Narendrapur, that even today, the scholars, some of whom are often described as Eurocentric, refuse to accept that Zero was invented in India. Now, when you take up the gauntlet, and when you present the facts before them, how do you tackle this challenge?
Well, thank you. This question is a bit controversial. Yes, it is fact that there are claims and counterclaims regarding the priority of the invention of Zero. But as far as personally I am concerned, I think this is not that important. It should be more academic in nature in trying to know and decipher the ancient periods of all the civilizations and to try and understand their own civilization, own methods of computation in its own right. Everything was beautiful. And comparing in terms of priority is a very difficult job here, because one of the greatest contender, India, there is no written records of ancient Indian time. You know that before the Ashokan edicts, there is nothing that were kept in writing in India, if I do not consider the Harappan seals, which are yet to be deciphered and understood properly. So the time period that we usually refer to when the idea of this number system was in vogue in India, one is quite clear about the fact that this decimal enumeration system was there in the Vedic time, because in Rig Veda itself, there are about 4,000 different word names of numerals, starting from these Eka, Di, Tri, Chatura. Still the largest one that one finds in the Rig Veda is Navatir Nava Shahasra, 99,000. In different contexts, these numbers are coming, and their number names, the way the naming was done in the Sanskrit grammar, if you look at that, then it is quite evident that these nomenclatures are following the decimal principle. So the decimal principle was in vogue even in the time of Rig Veda. Now, the time of Rig Veda itself is contested, but if you go by some, general estimate, it is at least 1,500 years before the time of Christ, if not earlier. So, this system was prevalent, but you do not find a single usage of zero in Rig Veda. Why? Because one must understand that you require express usage of zero only when you write the number in decimal system or any other place value based system. Talking about a number, say I talk about the number 100 or 1000, please try to appreciate that I don't need zero for that. The number has a name. What perhaps you are immediately looking at the back of your mind is that figure with one followed by certain zeros that is meaningful only when you write it. And writing in India came much later. So before that, there was no express need for the number zero. But that doesn't mean that the system didn't use it. The system was decimal, and a decimal system cannot work with just 1 to 9. The system requires the tacit presence of the concept, but you can't see it in writing. If you go to the other civilizations, like Babylonians had their own clay tablets, Mayans had their glyphs, Egyptians had their hieroglyphic writings or the hieratic writings of the papyrus, the Greek papyruses, everywhere things are documented in writing. So you can tangibly calculate and try to pin down their time of origin. In case of India, it is always difficult. In the same way of analyzing, if you want to look at Indian history and you go by a very conventional definition that for which I have written records, I will only accept that as history, then the large section of tremendously voluminous and rich civilization of India has to be ignored. Now that is not a very wise thing to do. Everyone knows that there was a very improved, advanced kind of civilization in India right from the Vedic period of times, and if not earlier, now that we know about Mehrgarh and Rakhigiri and other places, that there were civilizations even 8,000-10,000 BC in India. So comparing with other civilizations and putting things only in the sense of priority, that who is first, is kind of mere childish, if I may say so. Rather, we should try to understand and to appreciate and analyze every single civilization in its own beauty, and try to see that our forefathers throughout the globe, in different parts of the globe, some of them interconnected with each other, some of them without ever any known information about the connection with outer world like that of Mayans. How could they generate this enumeration system with so much potential in it to develop their mathematics?
Now, one question that comes to mind is, while India accepted zero, whatever the time period is, Vedic times is quite a large time period. At the same time, the Greeks didn't accept zero, nothingness. So why did this happen? Is this due to some philosophical difference between the seers of the two civilizations?
Well, that is a fantastic question. Actually, that is really mind-boggling to know the answer of this question. You know, it just so happens that if you look at the ancient Greece, the stalwarts, the thinkers, the philosophers, right from the time of Aristotle, you see that they are talking about things where they consider void and nothingness to be non-existent. There is no void, there is no infinity, everything is finite. That was their philosophical perception. Aristotle's dictum was that nature abhors vacuum. And though they were the natural inheritors of the Babylonian civilizations, and thereby they were aware of the place value based sexagesimal system that was there in Babylonia, and where from Seleucid period Babylonians had invented a special symbol representing their zero in the sexagesimal system, the Greek scholars preferred to shun the concept of zero. Why? Because every number for the Greek had a geometric shape. Geometry was something for them absolutely important in science. They had a tremendous penchant for geometry. And for every number, they had conceived several different shapes, like triangular number, like the number 3. You can place 3 pebbles on the ground in such a way that you make a triangle. They are just in the, you know, corners of the triangle, and that's how 3 is called a triangular number. Just increase it and you get larger and larger triangular numbers. There are pentagonal numbers, there are hexagonal numbers, and so on and on and on. Every number has one or more than one shape. So from that standpoint, they ask that if 0 stands for nothing, then how can nothing have a shape? What shape will nothing have? How can nothing be represented by something? And you see, with this kind of philosophical conundrums, they actually decided to avoid 0 as a number. There was another reason. You know, from the time of Pythagoras, they have invented the idea, they have invented the number, which are now called as rational numbers. Pythagoras, while playing the monochord, actually, empirically understood the idea of octaves by dividing a string in a certain ratio that will produce music and some other ratio that produces noise. So that's how the idea of ratio, and hence the rational numbers at a later stage, developed. There, the Pythagorean school and the later period, the thinkers, they did understand that 0 will destroy this conceived idea of ratio, because you cannot take the ratio of a number with 0. It destroys your arithmetic. So 0 must be avoided. You must shun 0. So consciously, knowing fully well about the usage and importance of 0, they decided to avoid 0. There was no 0, no infinity in Greek understanding of enumeration. Now come to India. In contrast to that, you will see that every school of Indian thought, philosophical school of Indian thought, they were not only embracing the idea of void and nothingness, they were actually analyzing it, trying to understand right from the Rig Veda, Nashadiya Shukta, Nashadasinna Sadasittadaning Nasidraja Navoma Parayat. The seer is asking that when at the time of creation there was nothing, absolutely no, this, not this universe, not this world, not the sky on top, in this complete vacuum, how this creation happened? Who is responsible for that? The idea of Nishkala Shiva in Tantra, the partless, formless God Shiva, who creates and destroys this universe again and again from the vacuum, and destroys into the vacuum once again. You see, in Maitreya Upanishad, the God Brahma is conceived as Esha Shuddha Shunna Shanta. The idea of Anaronyan Mahato Mohiyan of Kathopanishad, the God is conceived as minuter than the minutest, and simultaneously larger than the largest. Not only the conception of 0, the conception of infinitude. There's a dichotomy between these two in Indian philosophy. And God was conceived as both, as a simultaneity of nothing and everything. That was the philosophical understanding of void in India. And that is why the most common parlance in ancient India for the number, the numeral 0, was Kha, which stands for Gagana, Akasha, Ambara, the sky, the vast limitless expanse, Ananta, Purna. These are all equivalent words for 0. These are technically called Bhuta Shankha, word numerals. That was very necessary for maintaining the prosodical need when you make these sutras, or you make this in certain sense of rhythmic pattern, so as to make it easy for remembering. Not only just 0, every number had many equivalent terms. And for 0, you see that it was simultaneously conceived as Ananta and Purna. So it just so happened that when, at a point of time, the mathematicians living in that society understood the essence and need for using a symbol or a numeral for this concept of nothingness in mathematics, the society at large supported it. Unlike Greece, where the Hellenistic mathematicians in the Alexandria library, we have people like Theon, his daughter Hypatia. They were calculating their private calculations using the sexagesimal Babylonian system with zero, but formally representing that in the pure system of Greek alphabetic additive enumeration. Because society at large, right from the time of Aristotle, was against the usage of zero. And you know, that prevailed for 2000 years in Europe, because latter point of time, church embraced the Aristotelian doctrine. Going against Aristotle was tantamount to going against the church. And in medieval period, that could easily have cost your life. So that's the great difference between these two great ancient civilizations and their thinkers. That one, in Greece, they did have a reference to this number, but they chose consciously to suppress it, to avoid it, and that actually lamed their mathematical development for a long, long period. Whereas in India, you see, peoples coming from other doctrine, peoples who are not mathematicians per se, like Panini in Ashtadhyayi, he's a grammarian, but he's using a concept, Adarshanam Lopaha, which is very akin to the concept of vanishing, zeroing down, as we say in modern language. And it is very similar to the concept of absence of a numeral at a certain position, and that being replaced by the symbol of zero, which we call technically as the placeholder zero. We see the prosodist Pingala in his Chanda Shastra is talking about Rupe Shunyam, Di Shunne, and using it in a combinatorial calculation. We see Shubandhu in his famous play Vashavadatta in 4th century, common era, where you can see Shubandhu is using the term Shunno Vinda Vaiva Vilikhitam, alluring to the stars in the night sky as zero dots. Incidentally, the most ancient written form of Indian zero was a bold dot. It is not like the zero that we see today. That encircled boundary was filled in completely to look like a bold dot. And one can see such bold dot zeros in plenty in the famous Bakshali manuscript, which is now kept in the Bodleian Library of Oxford. The amount of tremendous mathematics, arithmetic in particular, in Bakshali manuscript is amazing. And all these calculations are done by decimal place value system enumeration with zero. Of course, again, time frame of Bakshali manuscript is still hotly debated. And as I have pointed out, whenever it comes to India, a very difficult situation to handle is the absence of direct evidences, direct written evidences in the really ancient period of time.
Professor Mukhopadhyay, while going through the galleries of this exhibition, we found that you and your associates have drawn up a map of how the word zero actually came up, how shunya even is connected to zero. And our listeners would like to know how this evolution actually occurred.
Well, the Sanskrit word shunya, it comes from the root suna. Suna yat in the past participle, it becomes shunya. The root shuna is akin to, you can find similar words in Rig Veda, like sunam, in the sense of vacuity, in the sense of absence, lack. And then by what the grammarians called semantic extension, this became the reference for nothingness. But as I told you, Indian idea of shunya was not just nothing. It was not just the negative nothing. It was a shunya of receiving, much like a womb ready to receive and swell. That was the philosophical concept of shunya. But you see, when this idea traveled from India to Arab countries through possibly Brahmasputra Siddhanta of Brahmagupta, the Arab scholars, in their own understanding of Sanskrit, they got the literal meaning of the nothingness only. And that's how they translated this as Sifra. It was Al-Khwarizmi in the court of Al-Mamun. He translated this as Sifra, which means in Arabic, nothing. And this Sifra letter was Latinized. All this Arabic translation letter before Renaissance was Latinized in Europe. And Sifra had several different connotations and names. To cut a long story short, one of the name was Sifre. Also there was Zifre, Zifra, Zifer. At a point of time in Europe, you must understand that this is the time when Europe was under crusade. Things coming from the Arab community was not welcome. It was as if coming from the Muslims, and hence it is against the church, who embraced as mathematics only the Greek legacy of geometry. So at a point of time, we see in history that this enumeration system, the decimal enumeration system, though it reached Europe, particularly in the Italy region, the businessmen, the shopkeepers, they were using it, but not publicly, because publicly it was banned by church, as it is coming from the Muslims. And that's how the system using this zero became the system of cipher. That's how zero has another name, cipher, nowadays, because it had to be done in secret. After a substantial amount of time, we find gentleman Leonardo Pisano, nicknamed Fibonacci, he is more famous by this name. In 1202, when he is writing the book Libera Bacchi, the book of numbers, he there referred to this system of decimals, where you can write any large number as you like by using 9 symbols and a special symbol for zero, as called by the Arabs. That's how he referred to it. You see, the representation itself tells that he was not sure about the level of zero with all the other numerals. He was hesitant in putting all of them in the same level. But he did understand that this system has the potential, against the clumsy Roman system, to simplify calculations much. And this new symbol in Latin he named as Zephyrum, which literally means light westerly breeze. So light that almost insignificant. Again, you see that idea of negativity, the idea of almost nothing prevailing in the nomenclature. Why suddenly westerly breeze? Because young Fibonacci used to travel with his businessman father Bonaccio in the eastern coast of the Africa. The then Africa is dominated by the Arab Moors, from whom young Fibonacci learned this new system. And later, when he became a mathematician and written the book Libera Bacchi, he coined this entire system and referred to it. Further down the line in history, the name Zephyrum gradually changed and distorted. It became Zephyro, and from that, in the local Venetian dialect, it became Zero, and then Spanish Cero, and finally our known zero in English.
So this is not only exciting, this is so informative. And when we listen to Professor Mukhopadhyay telling us the evolution, the path taken by this name to become today's zero, we actually see before us a horizon being opened up, a horizon dotted with civilizations of different ancients, a horizon with so many players giving a shape to the name, the idea, the application. And this is such a journey that we are not only introduced to a simple number, a zero, we are actually being introduced to unfolding of civilizational dynamics. In that way, we are enriched and we have actually no words to thank Professor Mukhopadhyay for shedding light on such a thing. Before we conclude today's episode, we would like to listen to a few lines being recited by Professor Mukhopadhyay, and that will put a finishing touch on this discussion and give you, the listeners, an idea of what the Zero Gallery at the RKM Residential College, Narendrapur, means.
The story of Zero is found meandering in so many other tales, as some glories are duly shared and some others are fated to fail. If history unjustly chose some benefactors to offer an unfitting fame for the first intellectual proprietary of Zero, we should still refrain from blaming each other. The story till date has quite a few diffused ends that need both our emotion and logic be simultaneously used to trace out the zigzag journey of Zero through different continents and ages, and know how our reasoned thinking evolved from such a confusing maze. India, once rising to the apogee of brilliance in her past academic march, lost her way in the passage of time. It's befitting that you keep your search on and more intense, dear students, as long as you can seize the day as you hear the calling to make your advances in a more maverick ways.
With that, we come to the end of today's episode of Power of Listening. We thank Professor Parthasarathi Mukhopadhyay and all the people who are associated with the Zero Gallery, the academicians, the designers, and we are really thrilled to listen to such a wonderful journey of Zero that has happened in the past and still keeps informing us, exciting us. Till we meet again, goodbye and good night.
Zero Gallery. You heard the 40th episode of our all-new series on traditional Indian knowledge systems, Power of Listening. The expert on the show was Dr. Parthasarathi Mukhopadhyay, Associate Professor, Department of Mathematics, Ramakrishna Mission Residential College, Narendrapur, Kolkata. Talking to him was Dr. Manas Pratim Das. We hope you enjoyed it. Our special thanks to AIR Kolkata and Randhir Thakur for their contributions. This program was produced by Dr. Manas Pratim Das and Vinod Kumar. This episode is also available on our official YouTube channel, Akashvani AIR. Be there on the 8th of July, same time, same frequencies. This is Manoj Mayankar signing off from Delhi. Bye for now.